Sunday on Close Up, Congressman Frank Inta remains on the job in Washington and has an eye toward re-election. But will voters trust him? We're going to sit down with him this morning to talk about a lot of things. Also, are you sick of hearing politicians talk about the heroin problem? We're going to sit down with a mother who is speaking publicly for the first time since she lost her son to this epidemic. And former Senator Judd Gregg weighs in on Donald Trump and his take on the rest of the GOP field. Morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us. I'm Josh McKelvin, Congressman Frank Inta. He's had himself quite a year, sworn in January, a spring in which many members of his own party kind of turned their backs on him after a deal with the FEC over illegal campaign contributions. And of course, Washington is rarely boring. Well, for some people, maybe it is. But Congressman Frank Inta is my first guest this morning. Good to see you, sir.
Good to see you. Us.
So yeah, here we are, August. Haven't spoken, at least on this program, since the whole FEC thing kind of blew up in the spring. Where do things stand now for you in terms of running for re-election?
Well, nothing has changed for me. I'm focused on doing the job. I would typically make an announcement about re-election next year, and that's what I will stay on course to do. But for me, nothing has changed. I'm focused on trying to make sure that I represent the people of the 1st Congressional District to the best of my ability. That's where I think people really want me to focus, and that's what I intend to continue to focus on.
And I'm not going to spend this program going back and forth about was it your money, was it your money. Anybody who's watching probably knows what the issue is and what your position is on it. But would you agree that you have some trust issues that you have to overcome in order to win re-election?
Sure. Major. I've got to talk to the people of my district about this and any issue that they want to talk about. And what I'll say is, look, for the last 15 years, I've served in one capacity or other in the state. I made a mistake on an FEC filing. I'm trying to move forward, but I'll certainly answer questions if people have them and do everything that I possibly can to look people in the eye and say, look, mistake was made. I've paid for it. I'm moving forward. I want to continue to represent you because here are the things that I've delivered on, things that I think that are important to the state, protecting the shipyard, dealing with the fisheries issues, bringing money back for drug courts to deal with the heroin issue, things that are New Hampshire-centric, delivering on results. Ultimately, that's what I think people tend to vote on election day.
Sure, but I think you're going to have to answer some more direct questions about that. Here's a snapshot of what your challenges are, a recent poll that we put out there. Favorability, throw that up there. Underwater significantly, more than 2-1, see an unfavorable light. Let's do it again. We actually asked whether people think that you should resign because you heard from Kelly Ayotte, said that she thinks you should. Other Republican leaders in the state said this as well. Chuck Morse, Sean Jasper, 44% of the people say that as well. So moving forward, and you got to raise money in order to win re-election. Have you mapped out a plan on sitting down with people, addressing this issue, and explaining, and make them believe you, I guess is my question to you.
Well, when I'm home, whether it's for this recess or whether it's the weekends when I'm in Washington, I make myself accessible and available to the people that I represent. If the question comes up, I answer it directly. The reality is if someone has a concern or a question, we will answer it and we'll continue to answer it to make sure that people are satisfied with the explanation that I've given. And that's what I can do. That's what I can control. But beyond that, people do still want to talk about the policy issues that are affecting them, their family, things that affect the state and national public policy issues. So I also obviously focus on that as I always have.
Looking back at it, is there anything you would do differently post the release of the FEC?
Yeah, look, Josh, I never anticipated that it was going to get to this level. I really didn't. But the reality is that I wanted to get this behind me. It became a bit of a political football during campaign season. That's really not where I want to be focusing when it comes to a campaign. You want to be focusing on what have you delivered for your state and what do you intend to do? And that became a bit of a distraction, which is why when the FEC called and asked me to settle, I took them up on that offer. I wish certainly things went differently. Maybe I could have handled it differently. But the reality is we're here. I answer the questions when people have them, and then I focus on the policy issues at hand.
Are you feeling pressure within the, I mean, are you repairing some relationships within the Republican Party here in New Hampshire, whether it's Senator Kelly Ayotte or others? Because there is a feeling that if you stay on the ticket, it'll drag it down. And you know that. I mean, you know that's the criticism. I mean, there's a lot of people out there in the Republican Party that hope that you just pack it up and do something else.
I've heard that criticism from a few people. In the last election in 2014, I was attacked on this particular issue. A lot of money was spent against me on TV and other media mediums, and I was able to successfully talk to the constituents that I was hoping to represent about this, and I was able to win. So I might have a difference of opinion than some of those people that you mentioned. I certainly continue to work with the delegation, work with people in the state of New Hampshire. I think people, as they see the results that I'm delivering on behalf of the district, people start to tend to focus on, okay, well, we're going to work with our member of Congress and try to get things accomplished on behalf of our state.
One more thing on this. We'll talk some of the issues in Washington. Very likely, I mean, we'll see, that you're going to face a Republican primary. One more poll number we're going to put up here when people ask whether you should run for re-election. They would vote for you 5%. 18% said they would consider it, while 55% of Republicans who were polled said they definitely will not. Seems like in a primary you'd be up against a serious challenge at the very least. Is this the number one issue that you have to deal with, do you believe, in order to...
I think it's an important issue to deal with amongst certainly any voter and any constituent. But time can heal some wounds, and I think people a year from now might think a little bit differently about this particular issue. After I've had some time to talk to people about it in a one-on-one conversation. So again, that's why I remain focused on doing the things that matter, trying to help people in the areas, whether again it's the heroin and opiate issue, or whether it's our fishermen in Seabrook and Rye, or whether it's trying to save the shipyard. Those things ultimately matter too.
Sure.
And we'll talk about all of that over the course of the year. But look, I've served for a long time in many different capacities. I appreciate serving. And I think people will be willing to sit down and listen to me and say, okay, you know, has Frank been effective? And do we like where he stands on policy? And do we accept the mistake that he made? We'll see how that turns out. But,
right.
You know, I'm focused on making sure that those questions get answered.
Yeah, and I'm sure that they will be asked quite a bit, and you'll probably see them in a lot of campaign ads. Let's talk about Planned Parenthood, obviously a major issue down in Washington. Where do you see this thing headed? Because, I mean, some want to defund the government, shut down the government in order to defund Planned Parenthood.
So I think what you're going to see in the House side are several committees of jurisdiction in September and October have hearings on the particular issue. I think most people don't support the notion of selling body parts, particularly of unborn babies. I don't support that, and I don't think the mainstream of America supports that.
Do you think that the government should do whatever, or the Congress should do whatever it takes, even if it includes a shutdown, in order to make sure that this organization isn't funded with taxpayer money?
I think what we should do is thoughtfully go through through the committee process, the hearing process, unravel everything about the issue, and then make an informed decision about how to best move forward in relative to taxpayer funding of Planned Parenthood. I don't support taxpayer funding of Planned Parenthood for this very reason. But we also have, I think, a mechanism to utilize those dollars for women's health and other entities that can provide women's health coverage throughout the country. So that's what we're going to try to grapple with in the House, and I think we'll do it in a thoughtful and timely fashion.
Yeah, it's an issue obviously up in Concord as well. Another topic, Congress has taken up the Iran deal.
Yes.
I mean, we'll see how effective it is, because the president will likely veto it, even if Congress gives it thumbs down. What do you think the chances are that there's enough votes there to make it veto-proof?
I think it's a bit of an uphill battle in the Senate. The House, I'm not so sure about. I think the House may be veto-proof. I'm not convinced.
What's the temperature,
though?
What are people saying? I mean,
well, when I come back home, I had a town hall meeting this week in Ossipee. The question came up. When I was out on the seacoast at different events, the question comes up. I mean, just no matter where I go, people ask me about the Iran deal. And I think people are legitimately concerned. So a couple things I say. First of all, it's a false premise to suggest it's either this deal or war. That's not true. Secondly, when you start to look at the deal itself, why would we give Iran $120 billion? Why would we lift the sanctions? Why would we allow them to use global financial markets again? Why would we allow them to be able to buy arms again? And why would we allow an inspection process that would take 24 days? And then now we hear a separate agreement, unbeknownst apparently to the Secretary of State, that they're going to be able to look at themselves rather than other inspectors. So
yeah.
When you start to look at those components of it, people start to scratch their head and say, wait a minute, I'm not sure that this is a good deal. Now, people say, if not this, then what? Well, existing sanctions, ratchet up the sanctions, and go back to the negotiating table and create a better deal that has on-site immediate inspection and zero capability for nuclear weapons.
We'll follow this closely. I'm just about out of time, but the heroin epidemic. Yeah. I mean, you've been the mayor of Manchester. This is a problem that hasn't existed before to this degree. Is the federal government doing enough? What more can we do? Because
we're not doing enough. First of all, I was able to at least start the process at the federal level by getting $5 million extra through the appropriations process for drug courts. That's part of it. But we need treatment facilities in this state. If you don't have the treatment facility, the drug court's not going to matter too much. So we've got to build up the infrastructure. We've got to deal with this like it is a true epidemic. My heart goes out to anybody who has become addicted to heroin, but let's be thoughtful about it. But we have to act immediately here in the state. On the federal level, we got to stop the drugs coming into this country, pure and simple.
Yeah, something that hasn't been talked about enough by the estimation of a lot of folks. Congressman, thanks for joining us
on
the program. We'll see you again soon. All right.